So we are very happy to have Victor Semikolas, is our old friend from our institute, has been here, I think, several years at least. At least 2 years as sabbatical visitor. And he is in his original institution, in Milan, and he'll give a review talk on the magnetic fields in magnetars.
Yeah. First, let me say my thanks to Jose who invited me, and I remember that we started our common work more than 20 years ago, so in the 90s, and we were doing neutrino physics, especially in magnetic fields.
Corabalaciones de Plata, this is called.
Yeah.
From 1990 to now is 25 years.
Yeah, almost like this. So this work was done together with Maxim Dvornikov, who is now in São Paulo, and the fresh paper is appearing now in GCAP, more extended version, additionally to PRD. And so I'll give you talk based on two papers, fresh papers, this year published. So my outline is here. It's enough for me, maybe 40 minutes, for 50 minutes, so don't worry that this long outline. First I'll tell you maybe some words what magnetars are. Telling about neutron stars as progenitors of magnetars. And then, because Maxwellian equations are linear over magnetic field, we need in seed magnetic field in neutron star. And our main ansatz is solution of Dirac equation for massless electrons, altruistic electrons in neutron stars in magnetic field, and with inclusion of electroweak electron nucleon potentials. So our calculations are based on parity violation in standard model. We apply only standard model, not beyond standard model. So, but including some anomalies. We did something similar with José, maybe, I forgot, maybe 5 years ago, explaining origin of Chern-Simons anomaly as polarization effect in, for hypermagnetic fields before electroweak phase transition. But this is not about electroweak phase transition, this is astrophysics of neutron stars with strong magnetic fields. Then I will tell, I'll derive kinetic equations for binary products of for magnetic fields, magnetic energy, which is B squared, and for magnetic helicity, which is B times A. A is vector potential. And important, also complementary to this kinetic equation is equation for mu 5, so-called chiral anomaly, difference of chemical potentials of right electrons and left electrons. And there are now many speculations on that, especially in QCD physics, in QCD plasma. I don't touch QCD, I consider QED in a standard model, including weak interactions. Then we developed our PRD version now, and I told that this will be published this month in GCAP, about growth of electric conductivity. This is important ingredient for physics of this phenomenon. I formulate initial conditions, and after that we solved numerically our kinetic equations and found how magnetic field, how magnetic helicity develops in neutron star.
So you look the growth both of the field
yeah.
and the
yeah, yeah, yeah.
topology, the shape.
Yeah, because look, helicity is proportional to magnetic field, so if magnetic field grows, also helicity grows. So I remind some known things, you know well. Because I know some people who are sitting here who are doing neutrino physics in supernova, so to find, for instance, bars of magnetic moment, neutrino magnetic moment. So you know such things, that stars with mass exceeding solar mass 8 times, you have supernova explosion, and you have remember number 10 to 53 erg per second is emissivity of due to neutrinos during first seconds. So and this is well known fact for particle physicists. The main mechanism. So I give all this here now. What is important for me, this process, so-called direct worker process, this capture of electrons by protons gives emission of neutrinos which move free, they are free, and after that you have, of course, contraction of matter and you have collapse. Peak luminosity is well known, and so after that we obtain as a supernova remnant, we obtain soon a neutron star. A neutron star, main characteristics of neutron star, the size is very, so you see only 10 kilometers, compares the sun has a million kilometer radius, and mass like this, and density is very high, so this correspond 10 to 14 gram per centimeter cube. This density, this number density of particles inside neutron star. Known facts. Magnetars. Starting from 1979, due to observations on satellites, people observed very strange phenomena that instead of gamma bursts, single gamma bursts, they observed some so-called soft gamma repeaters, and theoreticians could explain this only in the case if the star has very strong magnetic fields larger than 10 to 15 Gauss for this neutron star. And the period of rotation is something like 10 seconds, so much slower than for pulsars. You know that pulsar has mean period, pulsar has mean period like millisecond, so very fast rotation. But this star have slow rotation, not slow, because comparing with the sun, but a few seconds. And there are now several tens magnetars discovered by astrophysicists, and some people gave review for that. Also, we have contact with this guy who explained to us that we are way ahead, that there are many magnetars, not observed a few tens, but maybe much more comparable with number of pulsars. But we don't see them now because they are old now and they don't emit gammas and X-rays. But preliminary, before, they were magnetars, so there's very strong magnetic fields. And if we observe 10 magnetars, 20 magnetars, they really have 10 to 15, 10 to 16 Gauss. So this astronomical, astrophysical fact. We exploit this. Some people suggested models. First, who were Dalton and Thompson from Canada. They suggested mechanism for generation of these strong magnetic fields based on strong neutrino emissivity during first seconds. And they assumed the turbulent state for this stage. So they explained by fingers only the appearance of this strong magnetic field. And after that, some people criticized their model. And so what was recently done by a Japanese physicist, Anishi Yamamoto, who so they are somehow our competitors in these fields. They used chiral anomaly, difference of right chemical potential for electrons and left chemical potential to explain strong magnetic fields like this wave. Look, in the beginning, we really have direct Urca process with capture of electrons by protons. And so the number of left-handed electrons decreases. So you have disbalance, imbalance between right and left components from the start. But we showed with Dvornik that this mechanism acts only very, very short time, not enough to develop a strong magnetic field. We estimated this like 10 to minus 12 second only this
why does not
advantage is working.
Why does it not proceed further?
Because we have, from the start, we have chirality flip, left to right, and the rate of this flip is very huge. From standard estimates, and people agreed with us. This paper was only in archive, but not appeared in paper we published, so criticizing them, and we found mechanism. My talk is devoted to how to explain, if this doesn't work, how to explain strong magnetic fields. First, I told before that we need seed magnetic field, because Maxwell equations are linear, and we should assume some initial field like we did with you. For hypermagnetic field, always we need in the fluctuation field in order to develop. So, due to Maxwell equation, due to absence of monopoles, magnetic monopoles, you have this conservation for magnetic flux, this conservation law, magnetic field times surface. Area and this gives enhancement of proto star magnetic field, which can be very small due to this huge factor. Look, proto star has huge size, like our sun, 10 million kilometers, you see. And if you divide by 10 kilometers for neutron star size, you obtain this enhancement is factor 10 to 10. The sun has our sun. We know many things about sun, so I give comparison with the sun. Sun has mean field between 1 Gauss and 100 Gauss. In solar spots, we have even kilo Gauss. But if we substitute 100 Gauss, you easily obtain 10 to 12 Gauss, like for standard pulses. Now people know thousands. Pulsars, but so it's not a problem to generate 10 to 12, but there is a problem how to generate 10 to 15. And I'd like to explain how to explain such enhancement. Dynamo process, dynamo physics can give only seed field less than 10 to 16 Gauss, not bigger. Now, what we did, we considered Dirac equation for massless electrons. You didn't see here in Dirac equation mass 10. In the presence of a seed field, for simplicity, uniform field, vector potential like this, you know well that this usually gives Landau levels when you solve this equation without weak term. But we added also weak term in the matter, in a matter consisting of protons, neutrons, and electrons, and in principle from positrons too. Where in standard model from textbook you can find that in point line Fermi approximation you have vector potentials for left electrons like this and for right electrons like this. And P and PR usual projection operators which contain gamma 5. And the gamma 5 gives parity variation. We don't consider macroscopic. We don't consider macroscopic nuclear currents, so we consider here only neutron-proton densities. You know well this expression. This average means these brackets mean statistical averaging with Fermi distribution, standard Fermi distribution. And so you will see that this Dirac equation has a covariant form only due to absence of vector part. Only density part is presented here, and we solved this equation. I have some slides with details how we solved, but you don't need to see this. You can you well know that solution without weak term gives a Hermite polynomial for any Landau levels, and fortunately only main Landau level with Landau number n equal to zero gives contribution, and this corresponds old idea about polarization. So spectrum after solution is here. Energy minus potential I showed before. Z corresponds to directions of magnetic field, and n is Landau number. 0, 1, 2, etc. So we calculated with help of our wave functions, found solutions. We calculated mean current, electric current, and we found good formula, including this potential. We found that both chiral magnetic effect contributes, mu 5, which was used by Japanese physicists, but also our new potential, electric potential for electron and nuclear interaction gives contribution. And as I promised, I can explain why mu 5 vanishes, but this remains. And after that, we have generation due to this anomalous electric current.
Growth due to the V, not the mu.
Not the mu, yeah, exactly. Then, okay, this is the same. I explained that our anomalous current consists of two parts known before us. This CME effect, chiral magnetic effect, and also our current due to presence of Chern-Simons stem. And really weak interaction, like we explained 4 years ago. But for Kuiper magnetic field, for magnetic fields also, this second contribution, this corresponds to Chern-Simons stem in Lagrangian, if we use Lagrangian equation. Maxwell equation in magnetic hyperdynamics, MHD magnetic hyperdynamics. When all people neglect displacement current in left hand side consists of this standard term, and this is standard ohmic current which is proportional to the conductivity, electric field, macroscopic velocity, magnetic field, and G is anomalous current which I wrote before. So we can find from substituting this other current, this green line to this pink line, so we can find electric field, and using Bianchi identity, well known in, from textbooks for students, so we obtain Faraday equation. Faraday equation is here, and people who are doing the dynamo for magnetic fields always use this. This is so-called omega term, and this term is non-zero only in the case if you have differential rotation. We assume a solid state rotation of neutron stars, so this term is not important for us. Alpha is given by anomalous current, where I promised to kill this term, and this is our ansatz, which is interaction of electrons with nucleons, with parity relation. And this diffusion term, standard in magnetic hydrodynamics. Due to ohmic losses, this gives vanishing magnetic field if you consider long time this equation. So after that, we can write for mean magnetic field at large space B, called B, this equation. So from this, we obtain this finally, and we solve this equation. About magnetic helicity. About magnetic helicity. First who did this was Gauss. In 19th century, he calculated the double integral here. He found that this helicity, this pseudoscalar, is proportional to two magnetic fluxes. Let me show maybe just geometrical point. Look, what is magnetic helicity? Use my, by the way, look when. So, 170 years passed. He found, but he didn't know the standard model. And so in neutrino physics, Gauss. So this number, this linkage number gives you how many times you know that magnetic lines are closed. How many times they overlapped each other, yeah, like this. And here, this picture shows you that this number is 5. So 5 times you see that this magnetic flux is overlapped with another magnetic flux. And why this is pseudoscalar? But of course you understand why, because B is pseudo-vector, A is vector. So this should be pseudoscalar. But from this plot, you see that if you have northern hemisphere above and southern hemisphere below, if you have direction for magnetic flux to one side in northern hemisphere, if you look like mirror from southern side, you see opposite direction, and this gives change of the sign of number A. Instead of 1, you obtain minus 1. Instead of plus 2, you obtain minus 2. So this is pseudoscalar. And what is important also for magnetic helicity, that this gauge invariant value, if I'll use this transformation, integrating by parts, I easily obtain this term doesn't continue. Also, what is important? If I substitute Coulomb gauge for electric field and for magnetic field, differentiating H over time, I obtain this standard formula for MHD. This is proportional to pseudoscalar electric field times vector electric field time, times axial magnetic field. But in ideal plasma, conductivity isn't infinite. So in such case, electric field is connected with magnetic field with this formula. If I substitute this vector product to its side, I obtain zero. Yeah. And if I obtain zero, you see that this cancels. This value is cancelled. So, very good point. And Gauss was first who paid attention to such property of magnetic field. And we use this.
Second concern because of topological reason.
Yeah.
Not because of conservation, of symmetry.
For instance, magnetic field energy can be conserved, but also cannot be conserved due to the presence of rotation. So look, if I substitute even ideal power, if I substitute this value inside Bianchi equation, and if I times this by B, I obtain differentiating over time of energy. Yeah, I differentiate energy. But if you have V not zero, in such case you obtain that energy changes. Energy density, magnetic energy, changes due to the presence of rotation. If you use this differentiate by rotor or V, you obtain rotation, vortices of velocity. And so rotation contributes to the change of magnetic energy. But in the same ideal plasma, H is conserved, but magnetic field energy is not conserved. If you have rotation. Using Faraday equation, we found kinetic equations for binary combinations, for two binary combinations, I told you before, for helicity density, density because I divide by volume. This is connected with helicity spectrum. K is wave number, and you can integrate here, and usually you have contribution of many domains with different size of magnetic field. K corresponds to different size, to different scales of magnetic fields. And also magnetic field energy, which is here in Gauss units, is expressed through magnetic field energy spectrum. And spectrum is an important point. We derived kinetic equation for spectra, for helicity spectra, and for magnetic energy spectra. And our ansatz is here, you see, shown by the power. I mean V5. But if we have V5, which also depends on time, we should derive equation for V5. How? In order to close the system. But you see this nonlinear kinetic equations, H, magnetic field energy. Magnetic field energy is expressed through the same, and also we have this combination, this is expressed through helicity. So we need to close the system, we need to obtain kinetic equation for V5, for chiral anomaly. For that we use Adler anomaly. Usual Adler anomaly in QED for this gamma mu gamma 5. This was found by Adler in the 60s. If you differentiate this current, you obtain this pseudoscalar. But I told you before, Gauss was first who found such formula that dH over dt is proportional to the same. So I can combine these two equations, and I obtain conservation law where difference of right and left densities depends on this H. And so in the beginning of appearance of mu 5, when mu r and mu a of the same order as mu, mu is chemical potential for the generated emissive electron gas, neutron star. You know about this formula for this case. And in such case, from this law, we can derive the kinetic equation for mu 5, because mu 5 is changing over time, but mu is fixed. Mu is density of electrons inside the generated electron star. If we consider for time when this abundance is concerned. The third equation, closing the system of three kinetic equations is here. And again, our answer is here. What is important? That we added here flip term. Flip is proportional to mass. I told before that we consider massless electron gas, uncharacteristic electron gas. But flip is possible only due to the presence of mass. Flip changed from left to right, because in Dirac Lagrangian you have what? You have m, mu bar, psi bar, psi, yeah? So, but you have left to right connection in Lagrangian. So it's easy to understand for us why mass contributes to gamma flip. And helicity without flip is found from standard expression in MHD. But it depends on conductivity. And conductivity, for our first publication in PRD, we used constant conductivity. But in principle, conductivity is changed. How? The scattering of electrons of protons in degenerate electron gas, and also nucleons are degenerate. The nucleons are non-relativistic, but electrons are ultra-relativistic. Is proportional to temperature squared, because due to Pauli principle, because for the degenerate gas, all states are busy between zero and mu in the degenerate electron gas. So only if you take into account temperature, in such case, you can obtain non-zero collision frequency for electrons and protons. This gives the growth of conductivity when temperature decreases compared with the initial temperature. And grows significantly. So you see from here that this derivative is negative, and people who are doing neutron stars, they found this cooling of neutron star depends on some number index for emissivity, neutrino emissivity. I will show how. For direct Oort processes, this I showed before, and this neutron decay, this index corresponds to number 6, and emissivity 10 to 34. But these processes are impossible, become impossible when abundance of electrons becomes less than initial abundance. This number you know well, who were doing neutrinos from supernova, they know well that from the beginning the abundance of electrons was large, like 0.4. But at later times, this becomes less. In this case, this process don't proceed, and only modified Oort process in the presence of set body, neutron or proton, contribute. In this case, emissivity depends on index 8 here, and we substituted this index in the previous law derived by many astrophysicists. In this law, we substitute not 6, we substituted 8. This gives growth of conductivity due to growth of the time, like 1 cent. And we took into account this in our kinetic iteration. And now I will show plots. Helicity. Helicity starts from some value. In standard units, this Gauss squared centimeter. Why? Because this is binary combinations. Magnetic fields times vector potential over centimeter is magnetic field again. Yeah. So you understand the dimension units Gauss squared centimeter. Why 10 to 16 is initial? Because magnetic field at the start is 10 to 12 Gauss, like for particles. Squared 10 to 24. But size of the star is 10 to 6 centimeter, 10 kilometer. 10 kilometers is 10 to 6 centimeter. 10 to 24 times 10 to 6 is 10 to 30. So it's understandable why this, by fingers, why this such way. But it grows almost 10 orders during a very long time. And age of young magnetars is around 10,000 or 100,000 years. And here you see units, 10 to 5. So here unit is 10 to 5 years. And here for earlier times, this depends on scale we used. At earlier times, I show difference between Gerical fields and non-Gerical fields. Maybe I don't tell you before that. Look, I missed these initial conditions. So Q is characteristic which gives information about initial helicity. If Q is zero, you have a helicity from the beginning, but you can have this after. If Q is unity, this corresponds to maximal helicity. And it's easier to explain why this maximal. When your magnetic field is rotor A, so A times A times B contains angle sinus theta. And if sinus theta is unity, this corresponds to Q unity. But if sinus theta for this vector product is zero, you have zero initial helicity. And we used also Kolmogorov's spectrum for our magnetic field. We used also white noise and different cases we considered. And initial mu5 we used around 1 mV, which is much less than chemical potential of electrons, which is more than 100 mV. So I was correct when I showed that in the beginning mu5 was much less than mu. And using these initial conditions, we solved our kinetic equation, and I show you plots. So in the beginning, we have difference between non-Gerical field in the beginning, zero, and maximal Gerical field. But after a long time, after here you see thousands of years, after 10,000, 100,000 years, you cannot distinguish Gerical or non-Gerical initial fields. So non-Gerical field becomes to be maximum Gerical field, and this was our finding, maybe first time in MHD for neutron star. So I like this result. So here I showed you the same picture, but for much smaller size of magnetic minimal magnetic fields correlation length, 100 meters, which is much less than 10 kilometers. The size of neutron star. Before I showed you for 1 kilometer size here, here lambda minimum was 1 kilometer. Here I showed for shorter correlation lengths. And the same picture that helicity grows 10 orders almost. You can distinguish them for small times about 100 years between non-Gallical and Gallical fields, but after that, you can't see this. Now, mu 5. I promised to explain that mu 5 vanishes soon. Really, if you start from zero time, here dimensionless units in diffusion time, t is useless in seconds, and due to this, the presence of wave number and conductivity, the dimensional value. So at the beginning, during 10 to minus 12 seconds, you have killing of this mu 5. And this continues a long time, and approximately around 1,000 years becomes to lower down, becomes negative instead of initial zero, and but remains less than V5. This is important. So here I show you the same U5 decrease during long time, here 10 to 5, to approximately between 100,000 years, and then, and here for less scale, here for scale 1 kilometer, for minimal scale 1 kilometer, here for 100 meters, correlation length of magnetic fields. Now, now about magnetic field itself. Magnetic field also, from the beginning, you can distinguish at the start, this corresponds 10 to 12 Gauss, as I told. But at the beginning, you can distinguish it between non-Gallical and Gallical fields, but then you can't distinguish them, and non-Gallical field becomes to be a fully Gallical field, and it grows from 10 to 12, 10 to 10, to 15, 10 to 16, I don't see. Probably. So five order of magnitudes, if helicity grows 10 orders of magnitudes, magnetic field itself grows five orders of magnitude. Yeah, 16, here 16. 14, 16, so this is approximately 17, yeah? So five orders of magnitude.
What is the difference between the left and right? It's just the time scale?
Yeah, this different time scale. At the beginning, at the start, you can distinguish your initial condition. Our initial conditions were, we considered different initial conditions, non-Gallical and Gallical, in fully Gallical field. And this corresponds non-Gallical field, solid line, and dashed line corresponds fully Gallical field. And fully Gallical field grows faster. But if you consider much longer time, in the left panel. In this case, you see that they become closer and closer to each other, and so you can't distinguish Gallical or non-Gallical initial fields. So this is a good point.
I mean, in the evolution, you have both the effect of the mu 5 and the V5.
Yeah, but you asked me about another. Why?
Yeah, I still don't understand. I mean, it looks like the right is a zoom version of the left.
Yeah, like so.
But in the
right. Yeah, but you don't see here, you can't recognize here, so scale is different here, time
yeah.
scale. And if you use such scale, let's say less than 10 to 4, so half, 500 years, 5,000 years, but you have here only units 100,000 years, so you can't see the difference. So. In order to show difference.
So what you're saying is that the helicity grows up to a certain point and then it stops growing.
It stops, yeah, and stops, and after that they so move
no
together
longer.
Like.
But this is, sorry, this is just with the mu 5. With your new effect?
Yeah, I forgot about Mu5. I showed you before this plot. Look, Mu5 became zero very fast, and it remains zero long time. This corresponds approximately 1,000 years. I mean, this from zero to this 1,000 years. After that, this becomes negative, has some value, non-zero value. But this value is less than V5. What is important for us? That even this maximal negative value, maximum, I mean modular, is less than V5. And this very nice result that V5 at the beginning vanishes soon, but even becoming bigger on model, it remains on model less than positive V5. Let me return to differential equation. We always had in our differential kinetic equation the sum. If this zero during a very short time, okay, this is good. But after that, this becomes negative and grows on model. But the sum of this remains positive. And we have good effect because this is positive. This back reaction from growing magnetic field kills Mu5 additionally, and this stems becomes even bigger than gamma due to flip. Gamma due to flip kills Mu5 at very short time, but after that, I had long time zero value of Mu5, but then due to this large term, this derivative becomes negative and bigger than this. But in any case, this sum remains positive. That is important for growth of magnetic field here. Look, this is plus and this is plus. And if this sum remains positive, Mu5 being negative is less in model than V5, we have growth of helicity and we have growth of magnetic field energy. All three equations, kinetic equation, are important and very combined, and very easy solved, and we obtain finally these rules of magnetic field, five orders of magnitude. So this almost finished. Summary: the electric current averaged over the solution of Dirac equation for massless electrons gives anomalous combining with current of chiral magnetic field effect, which is proportional to Mu5, and this is minor comparing with weak interaction Chern-Simonstein. And I wrote here in this conclusion that model of Mu5 here is less than, I missed here, index 5. Is less than V5. And electrolytic electron nuclear interaction drives growth both magnetic helicity and magnetic field in neutron star. In the initial non-Guericke fields becomes maximum Guericke field. I showed you the big, at the beginning they are different, but then the common result. And it grows due to Chern-Simons anomaly supports the growth of magnetic field in macroverse. So that's all. Of course, I have another slides, but I don't like to show to delight you.
Questions? Yes.
An average over the whole star, or is it the center, or is it the surface, or
averaging of what?
Sorry.
Averaging of what do you ask?
All over the star. I mean, because you are saying it's about the gas. Which part of?
Look, I showed you different scales. I showed you 100 meters, kilometer, and also maximal size, maximum correlation length corresponds to the size of neutron star, 10 kilometers. And if I consider continuous spectrum, we have inverse cascade for magnetic field. Small scales become bigger and bigger due to inverse cascade. And we took into account, we integrated over K this spectrum. And maximum scale of magnetic field we consider here is 10 kilometers. After that, after that you have core of neutron star. And people observed these soft gamma repeaters give you emission of gamma, soft gamma rays and X-rays due to tension of magnetic field on the core. And after that, some plasma penetrates this core and is outside electron-positron plasma. And this electron-positron plasma moves in the same magnetic field, which from this hole penetrates outside of the star. So don't think that I considered only 10 kilometers. Of course, I consider maximal size is 10 kilometers for magnetic field. But if we didn't consider dynamics of explosions, so of this phenomenon for gamma soft repeaters, X-ray anomaly, neutron stars. And magnetic field influences this emission, and due to rotation of the star, like in end of 80s, people found in satellites period of 8 seconds, exactly like in parcels, when your axis doesn't coincide with pole of magnetic field. In this case, you have repeated bursts of gammas observed on satellites, on detectors. But what is interesting, this is not my business, what is interesting is that first Mazets, Russian physicists who observed this on a Russian satellite, and simultaneously, during the same day, people in American satellites observed the same phenomena. But this lasted only, let's say, a few seconds, maybe not bigger than 1 minute. But past 5 years, and again from the same source, people found the same phenomena. That in, sometimes, due to magnetic field tension, again you have penetration of plasma outside of magnetar, and this cloud of electron positrons, which is fixed by a strong magnetic field, emits again gamma rays we observed here on satellites. But maybe you don't even ask about that, but... But you asked about size of magnetic field, so maximum is 10 kilometers.
Whether in the interior of the star, the core of that could be even larger than the gene, or that's the explanation.
It couldn't be, people say it couldn't be larger than 10 to 17 gauss. There are some reasons for that. I remember one reason, my collaborator Lenson, who explained, who was working here with Armando Perez, told me that when magnetic field becomes to be 10 to 17, 10 to 18 gauss, in such case, Larmor radius for proton becomes less than size of proton, and you have decay of proton. So this will be very strange physics. So 10 to 17 is maximum. We didn't finish this problem. There are many questions. We didn't, so this we only explained somehow get this magnetic field. But concrete value, 10 to 15, 10 to 16, 10 to 17,
One last question. Yes?
Within this model, what is the causal mechanism that distinguishes between Bucket laws, where the field grows to such values, and operate Newton's law, where presumably it doesn't?
Repeat.
This mechanism appears to be able to grow the magnetic field to 10 to 16, 17 Gauss in Bucket laws. But on the other hand, there are normal Newton's laws with much weaker fields. So it probably shouldn't work in all Newton's laws. What is the parameter or mechanism which turns it on or off?
Good question. Very good question. So Newton stars, like pulsars, they have much less magnetic field. But if you took into account, differential rotation, we consider only solid state rotation of Newton's star. In such case, our kinetic equation become not valid for differential rotation. And in the beginning, when star was, let's say, not thermally relaxed, you have the turbulent state after supernova explosion. Probably other mechanisms are active, not our mechanism. So this depends on initial situation for protostar. If protostar had long time differential rotation, in such case magnetic field can grow like 10 to 5, 10 to 15, 10 to 16 Gauss. Probably they remain 10 to 12 Gauss. But some experts who are observers and who know well, we contacted with Woods, this guy, he told that the abundance of magnetars is comparable with pulsars, with normal stars, normal Newton stars with, let's say, moderate value of magnetic field, 10 to 12.
Okay, so let's stop here. Professor Stemnikos is going to stay till he leaves on Thursday in the morning. So tomorrow he'll be here. Okay, thank you very much.